Thank you for worshiping with us. I know you are so important for God and for us. And I'm so grateful for each of you to be with us this morning. We had an amazing virtual concert yesterday on November 14th featuring with Matthew Smith. And if you missed it, I encourage you to check it out on our YouTube channel anytime. And we are preparing another virtual concert in Christmas season on December 13th at 7 o'clock featuring New Jersey Master Chorale and HUMC ensembles, as well as some previous year's recording. So please do not forget to mark your calendar to join our virtual concert. Thank you for journeying with us to deliver God's hope to our local communities. I want to update you that we have collected over 7,500 items for Cherry Hill Food Pantry since March and over 450 items for Urban Promise, including Thanksgiving collections. So thank you. And please remember, today is the last day for making your contribution for Thanksgiving food collection. It is a great privilege to be partnering with you as we make big impact and differences in our community. In order to deliver Christmas joy and surprise to children and youth in the area, we will be giving toys to children in the Camden area, and Operation Bear Hug will collect a teddy bear. For those who stay in hospitals during Christmas season in this area. So due to the pandemic, we will not physically visit the children, but we can still deliver our love and joy as we drop off bears in an acceptable way this year. So please find the Christmas collection box in the church breezeway to drop off brand new toys, books, gift cards, apparel, and teddy bear sized 8 to 12 inches. And please find more information on our website about ongoing current mission drive at haddonfieldumc.org/serve. November is our stewardship month when we are invited to make our pledge for the next year as we pray and plan our ministry together for the year to come and to keep moving forward together. So if you haven't had a chance yet, please find the pledge card on haddonfieldumc.org/2021pledge card. Thank you for your generosity during this challenging season. You can continue to use our online giving on our website or HMC app or mail a check to the church office, 29 Warwick Road, Haddonfield, New Jersey, 08033. So let's continue to worship our loving God.
Hi everyone, I'm Parker and this is Paxton. And today we are going to talk about the impact of our actions on others. For this experiment, you are going to need Skittles, a plate, and some water.
Line the outside of the plate with Skittles. Next, pour enough water into the plate so that the bottom of the Skittles are coated with water.
Let's see.
Now watch what happens. We see that the colors of the Skittles dissolves into the water and flows into the center of the plate.
I think it's going to turn into lots of colors.
Oh, they're dissolving! Ooh,
this is so exciting!
Why don't the colors mix? It's because the color coating on all the Skittles are water-soluble. This means that they start to break down when they touch water. When the coating is coming off, it spreads into the water at an even pace. Because of this, there is not enough force to mix the colors.
Every one of us is unique with our own personalities and gifts. Embracing our difference helps us to grow as people and learn about ourselves and the people we want to be. Our actions help to shape the people around us. Like the water in this experiment, accepting others as they are and leading with love helps to bring out the unique colors in all of us and makes the world a more colorful and kind place. Try this activity at home with your family and see what results you get. Have fun and see you next week! Bye!
Good morning. Let us join together in the call to worship. This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. God has chosen you and me for this life. We are beloved children of God. Let us not worship God only with our mouths and our minds. Let us worship God with our hands and our feet. Praise be to you, O God, who has brought us into this life, and you call us to make an impact through the love of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
I'm so grateful for this time of prayer with you, coming to God who sees our hearts and who always listens to our spoken and unspoken prayers. And I praise God for the blessings we enjoy in our daily life and lift up our prayers and concerns to our God, because God makes us whole. And especially today, I recognize our loss and mourning for our beloved ones, as individual and as a community during this time of pandemic. And we mourn our loss of all who have died recently. And as we ask God's consolation, peace, and comfort for their families and friends, would you please join your heart with me in prayer? O God of all creation, thank you for your invitation, calling us into your presence as we gather in your name. We give you thanks for all the ways we have been touched by your grace in our daily lives. A simple phone call with friends, laughter over silly things, sunrise or sunset happening every day, and the gift of life itself. Thank you for all the beauty that lifts our spirits and the kindness that is springing up all around us as we breathe in your spirit and breathe out our praise. O precious Lord, during this challenging season, we dare to open our whole selves to your transforming work of love. We have discovered the many challenges that we often place in the way. We recognize how often we rest in complacency, not appreciating the simple pleasure in life, how attached we become to controlling our environment. Save us from our fears and our selfish tendencies, that we might become the people we want to be, the persons you have called us to be. O compassionate God, we recognize our deep grief in this unprecedented season of life. We pray for those who are mourning at this time, for their loss of beloved family or friend, and pray for your consolation in their lives rooted in your love and promise. Once again, we lift up our prayers for those who have experienced any kind of loss during this time. Show your mercy and bring your healing on their body, mind, or spirit, and let them experience your deep peace that the world cannot give. O loving God, in the midst of this gathered community, we find so many needs. We pray for each of the vulnerable all around us. Grant them comfort in this time of uncertainty and isolation. For the healthcare workers and the first responders, renew their energy and sustain them well. For each one who is bowed down with an anxiety about tomorrow's problem, silence their worries and fear, but fill them with your love and hope and new opportunities in their lives. Wherever we find ourselves, we trust that you meet us there. Make us one in Christ and renew our hearts so we can choose gratitude and service and hope. Use each of us as your tool to bring peace and reconciliation, hope and love in the places where we are. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus our Christ, who lived, died, and was resurrected for us and taught us the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Joyfully sing, 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 joyfully sing Today's scripture reading will be from 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 to 17. You must understand this, that in the last days, distressing times will come. For people will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, inhuman, implacable, slanderers, profligates, brutes, haters of good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, holding to the outward form of godliness but denying its power. Avoid them. For among them are those who make their way into households and captivate silly women, overwhelmed by their sins and swayed by all kinds of desires, who are always being instructed and can never arrive at a knowledge of the truth. As Yannas and Yambres opposed Moses, so these people of corrupt mind and counterfeit faith also oppose the truth. But they will not make much progress because, as in the case of those two men, their folly will become plain to everyone. Now you have observed my teaching, my conduct, my aim in life, my faith, my patience, my love, my steadfastness, my persecutions and my suffering, the things that happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. What persecutions I endured! Yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. Indeed, all who want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. But wicked people and imposters will go from bad to worse, deceiving others and being deceived. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have known the sacred writings that are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and in training in righteousness, so that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
We know that others impact our lives.
And we know that faith can impact our lives.
But did you know that you can make an impact in the lives of others? Yes, you.
Yes, you, no matter how tall
or small.
No matter how young
or old.
You can make an impact using your God-given talents at any age,
at any time.
I make an impact by listening and offering perspective.
I make an impact by sharing my faith through sharing my musical talents, either on Sunday morning, Wednesday night, or for Steeple Club.
I make an impact by singing in the church choir and singing solos to the glory of God.
I make a difference by sending cards to people.
I make an impact by serving on both the district committee and the conference board of ordained ministry.
I make an impact working with my connect group. We discuss the service, we discuss the sermon, and then we have a great time connecting with each other.
I make an impact by chaperoning with our youth group so that our youth can stay connected to our congregation and the community.
I make a difference through being a part of the music program here, and it's been my joy to be a part of the children's music ministry and directing a choir for a number of years with these lovely young children.
I make a difference by donating food to the food pantry.
I make an impact by participating in United Methodist Women and the Stephen Ministry. And I also hope that I make an impact by encouraging others to follow Christ.
You can start the ripple.
You can be a super spreader of love.
You can make an impact.
Who inspires you? Think of someone who has made a difference in your life or in the world around them. What is it about them that inspires you? Chances are high that they have had to overcome something, rise above difficult circumstances, or overcome a disability or a complicated reality or something that they have had to struggle against and transcend. That's usually what inspires us, someone who encourages us ourselves to persevere, to push through, and to rise above. Someone who inspires me is a young woman named Caitlin. When I was serving as the associate pastor at the Pittman United Methodist Church about 15 years ago, Caitlin was probably in the third grade. She and her mom and her two sisters had survived domestic violence. They had lived through a house fire. They had endured much. And yet Caitlin was always upbeat and she always wanted to help people. I remember at that time, she started a ministry led by a third grader called Angels of God. And they would deliver flowers and treats and other things to people who were in need or lonely or those who couldn't leave their homes. And often, Caitlin would drag the adults with her, the pastors, staff, Sunday school teachers. She was driven to make a difference in people's lives because others had helped her family, had helped her. Well, a few years ago when I moved down to Haddonfield, back to South Jersey, I went through Pittman one day and I was surprised and not surprised to drive through downtown and I saw a building with a sign that said Angels of God. Now known as Angels Community Outreach, Caitlin's efforts when she was about 8 or 9 years old turned into, when she was 12, a 501c3 that became a community outreach ministry or a project, giving folks supplies and clothing, a clothing closet, and much more to help people who were in need. Now continuing to be run by her mom and her family and community partners, the communities of outreach in Pittman helps people just like Caitlin's family. She made a difference at a time and an age when we don't see all that much of an ability or potential within someone, but it came from her, from a place of both of overcoming, but gratitude for those who helped her to overcome. People who helped her family with clothing and housing and other things. And she had a drive at a very early age to give back and to help people around the community. I'm grateful for people like Caitlin and have deep faith in her ability to impact the world around us and her ability to inspire other people to do something with the little things that we have in the moments that we have them to make a difference, to make an impact. But making a difference almost always comes at a price or a cost. When we want to do something significant, there are always barriers or entries that have to be overcome, things that we have to deal with that we didn't think we would have to, or unexpected situations we have to push through. Anything worth doing or anything that makes a true difference requires perseverance and requires overcoming and rising above. The Apostle Paul knew this when he wrote to Timothy, one of his disciples. Paul was in a Roman prison in Rome, and he was writing to his young student, the evangelist Timothy, who he was in many ways turning the reins over to spread the Jesus movement, to care for the churches, and to continue to spread the news of the gospel all throughout the region. And Paul says to Timothy these words in the third chapter of 2 Timothy, which is his second letter to Timothy. He starts out and he says, "You must understand this, that in the last days, distressing times will come." He's breaking the news to Timothy that it's not always going to be easy. It's actually going to get more difficult before things get any better. He goes on to say, "For people will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, inhuman, implacable, slanderers, profligates, brutes, haters of good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God." What he's saying to Timothy is when you go and you share a message of love and of salvation and of redemption and of serving the least of these, not everyone's going to want to hear it. Not everyone is going to see it as good news because they're going to be focused on themselves, and there will always be charismatic leaders and teachers and preachers and other figures and celebrities who show an easier way, a way that is focused on the self and prosperity and success. But Paul tells Timothy to keep pushing forward, to overcome, because he knows the value and the precious substance of the gospel of Jesus Christ that always takes the focus off of us through the gift of humility and onto what God has done, is doing, and will do. Paul goes on to tell Timothy about the dangers ahead, about the difficulties he will have to overcome, and about the perseverance that he will have. But in the very end of this chapter, in verse 17, he says, "So that everyone who belongs to God may be proficient, equipped for every good work." So that everyone will be proficient and equipped for every good work. Because that is indeed the task of those who sow the seeds of the gospel, who spread the good news of Jesus Christ, is to do it in word, but also is to do good in the world. I am reminded of the words that are ascribed to John Wesley, one of the founders of Methodism, that he supposedly said, although it's contested, "Do all the good in all the ways you can, by all the means you can, at all the times that you can." There is this understanding that doing good, making a difference in the world around us, goes hand in hand with the gospel of Jesus Christ. But doing good isn't always easy for a lot of reasons. One is we don't always feel good. There are times like this moment that we're living in now. If ever this verse would ring true, there are difficult times ahead. We don't always feel like doing good. We don't always know how to do good, and we question whether or not we have the ability to actually make a difference. If I do this, will it actually change anything, or will it make a difference? Back to John Wesley, there is something very fundamental to early Methodist belief and practice and theology that has been a driving force in my own life and my ministry. And if we can just do a early Methodist theology primer here for a quick moment, bear with me. I want to talk to you about the way that John Wesley understood God's grace. Now, grace is the gift of God's love that we do not earn. It's unmerited love. God loves us and forgives us not because we are good, but because God is good. That is grace. All Christian traditions, denominations, and sects believe in grace. But John Wesley understood grace as having three movements, like symphonies have three or four movements. Grace, in the Wesleyan understanding, has three movements. There's first the overture, meaning that God is active in our lives, in people's lives, without our knowledge or without our permission. We don't have to say yes to God for God to be present and active and doing good and sowing seeds and doing the work of redemption around us. Wesley called that prevenient grace, a grace that goes before our understanding, that whether or not you believe in Jesus Christ, whether or not you accept Jesus Christ into your life or your heart, God is at work in you. Now, the most common understanding of grace is when we say yes, when we say yes to God, when we say yes to Jesus. Some use the language of John 3, to be born again, or to have a heartwarming or a salvific experience. Wesley would call this justifying grace, meaning this is the encounter when we say yes to God. Yes, I believe, and yes, I want Jesus to live within me. This is the apex of the symphony. This is the movement where things really start to get cooking. And when we say yes to Jesus, our life begins to change. We, like in Paul's letter to Timothy, we back away from some of these dangers: selfishness, pride, competition, fighting, quarreling, all of the things that Paul names here and in other letters. We abandon a self-pursuing life to pursue a life for God and to serve and to do good for others in the world. That is justifying grace. And for a lot of Christian denominations, that is everything. But Wesley believes that there is a third movement, and this has defined Methodists for the last three centuries. And that movement of God's grace is what he called sanctification, which means if you have Jesus living in your life, you cannot help but do good in the world. You cannot help but want to make a difference, to love and to care for. And so therefore, we as Christians are not just those who possess a ticket to the kingdom and say, yes, I am in, and that's everything. Wesley says that if God is living in us, we cannot help but produce fruit. Jesus said in the Gospel of Matthew, you will know a tree by its fruit. If it is a healthy tree, it will produce healthy fruit. Jesus said of his disciples at the Last Supper, they will know you are my disciples by the way you love one another. So Wesley in the 18th century said to this movement, this group of people called the Methodists, if we truly believe that God is good, if we truly believe that God loves us, then we have but one possibility. That is to then go and to share that love, to spread that love, and to do good in the world. It is an outpouring. Now, I will say that throughout history, some people have misunderstood this theology to say that, oh, look, those Methodists are trying to prove that they're good enough, or that they're do-gooders that are just focusing on being good in the world. But that's missing the point. The point is that if we believe that God is good, then the good we do is an outpouring. It's an offering, a thanksgiving. It is living out gratitude. As I think back to 8-year-old Caitlin, she was able to possess a gratitude for people who helped her family in a way that she couldn't help but to want to help others and to make a difference. And the fruit of what she took on at age 8 and 12 today and this year continues to serve a population and a community. She planted seeds that have continued to bear fruit even beyond just what she did as an individual. Today, in this moment, there are difficult days ahead. There are difficult circumstances that we are living in for so many reasons, for the dangers of the coronavirus, the difficulty of living isolated lives, the challenge in the economy, the climate of the nation and of the world. But difficulty should not cause us to step back or to shut down, but instead it is something that God wants us to overcome, to persevere through, and to not get caught in the traps of just pursuing happiness, like it's a destination. For people who think that happiness is a destination, if I can only get this and achieve this and buy this, then I will be happy. We realize in time that no matter what we do, that destination is always moving. But if our purpose is to make a difference one person at a time for the glory of God, not because we're good, not because we're trying to be good enough, not because we're just trying to be do-gooders in the world, but because we're reflecting the light that God has already poured on us. You see, before I believed in God, God was planting the seeds all around me in good people. God's grace was working in my life when I was doing things that are embarrassing to this day. When I was making bad decisions, God was setting me up with good people and good possibilities. And then through great hardship, great difficulty, and even trauma, I encountered God's love. And I said yes. I said, yes, I want you to work in my life. But over the last few decades, I haven't been able to be stagnant. But it has been a journey of trying to let that love flow through me. My siblings in Christ, I want to say today to you, you can and you do make a difference in the decisions that we make, the way that we are community with each other. It is easy right now to isolate ourselves or to feel insignificant or to feel helpless. But the difference we make is dependent upon our willingness to get up, to avoid the traps of all the things that Paul says, to be possessed by our anger or our resentment or our ego or our need to win, our need to be right, our need to be only with people who think like we think. Those are traps. If we can overcome that trap and submit our lives to God's grace, who sees all people as God's children, whether they accept it, acknowledge it or not, if we allow God's grace to flow through us and we let it define the good we do in the world today, I promise you, you make a difference. There is a writing in the Talmud, which is a historic Jewish commentary on Hebrew scriptures. And it says these words, "Do not be daunted by the enormity of the world's grief. Do justly now. Love mercy now. Walk humbly now." You are not obligated to complete the work, but neither are you free to abandon it. Dear friends, don't be daunted by the enormity of the world's problems, by the enormity of COVID-19, by the enormity of the strife in the world. And know that you and I are not responsible for wiping out a pandemic or poverty or conflict, but we also aren't off the hook for participating in what God is doing now. Each week when I say that we are to be the church in a hurting world, I want you to know very clearly what I mean is that we are to go and believe that God is at work in everyone. People who are Methodists or Christians or not, know that God loves them, created them, and is at work in them. So the way we treat them is as our siblings, as beloved children of God, whether they like us or not. And we are, day after day, to say yes to Jesus, to say yes to the one who came to save us and to love us and to work through us and to nurture that relationship through prayer, through worship, through the reading of scriptures. But also to be the church means to not stop there and to seek to make a difference one person at a time by participating in what God is doing. I am so grateful that we have continued to be the church in a hurting world. Since the pandemic started or really hit in March, this church has given almost 8,000 food items. We've donated over $15,000 to help food insecurity in this area. We have donated dollars and supplies for thousands of masks for people who need it. We have been investing in making a difference. And if you feel like, oh, you know, I'm not really sure if it matters, you know, you go shopping at the store and you buy food for your family and you may pick up a box of spaghetti and you put it in the box, you might not know if that makes a difference or if it really changes anything. But if you're the family who is really struggling to figure out how to eat and what to eat, and you sit down and you have a very filling and substantial meal of spaghetti, you know the difference. You know the difference between that box and not that box. If you've ever been blessed like that, let it flow through you. If you've not had to be in that circumstance, know that you are blessed and let the gratitude for that blessing flow through you. So let us go from this place, from this experience, your phone, your computer, wherever you may be, go in spirit and know that God is making and wants to make a difference in the world through you. One experience, one box of spaghetti, one phone call, one prayer, one person at a time. Amen.
Simple song, Lord, make it up as you go.
Blessed be the man who loves the Lord.
Thank you for joining us today. As we go, let us remember our small kind words or actions can make a great impact on someone in the ways we could ever imagine when God works in and through us. So it's challenging, it can be challenging, but it's a great joy to work with God. So keep the faith and stay in God's love. Hope you have a blessed week and see you next week.